The depths of the ocean are nearly unexplored, and as such, there are likely thousands of creatures we know nothing about. Yet, there are some we have witnessed, but have little to no information on.
That giant oarfish that washed ashore in Oceanside is now being dissected.
Marine biologists are trying to learn more about the long sea serpent-like fish. 10 News reporter Hannah Mullins was there as the oarfish was cut into pieces, and she has the new details on what we've learned so far.
I can tell you it smells absolutely horrible. I can also tell you she was pregnant, and these are just some of her eggs, and it's just the beginning to what scientists hope to learn.
How a very large animal like an oarfish can be so poorly known is one of the facts of life of deep sea biology. The ocean is invisible, and the deeper you go, the less possibility is to see anything. There's only a few deep sea submersibles like the Alvin, the US one, that can go that deep. I've dove on the Alvin to the hydrothermal vents. That's 9,000 feet deep. More people have been to the top of Mount Everest than have been that deep. Now, why are they so interesting? It's firstly the legend. Even today, almost always only seen when they come up to the surface, usually to die. And this is a big fish. It's the largest bony fish in the world, longest bony fish. It's records up to 30, maybe 50 feet. And so when a very long fish comes on up to the surface and is writhing around there, it's the origin of sea serpent legends. The oarfish then becomes something that has grabbed people's attention for a couple of hundred years. And so when you then get one, you know just nothing about it. Have lots of odd structures, and nothing is known about their biology. So they're inherently a source of curiosity.
Well, we still don't understand a lot about their biology. For instance, we don't know how old, how long they live, how quickly they grow, how old a 7-meter-long specimen is. We just simply have no information about that.
And it's this lack of information that leads to curiosity in the scientific community about the oarfish. As more and more sightings, strandings, and beachings occur, we gain little bits of information about the creature. What do we know? Oarfish are massive. In fact, they're the longest bony fish alive, growing up to 36 feet in length. Historians speculate that oarfish are actually the source of many sea serpent tales, though they're completely harmless. Oarfish lack major anal fins or caudal fins, but make up for it with approximately 400 dorsal fin rays, the first 10 which are elongated to varying degrees. The oarfish has a small yet wide mouth and no visible teeth.
New tonight, 10 News viewers tipped us to a major discovery in Oceanside of a creature rarely seen by humans. But what makes this sighting of an oarfish even more puzzling is it's the second one to wash up on a Southern California beach just this week. 10 News reporter Riel Creighton is in the Live Center with who showed up when we went to investigate. Riel.
Right, this is actually what it looks like swimming deep underwater. Strange for just about everyone who saw its lifeless body, but even more so when it washes up dead Oceanside twice in one week.
What appeared in Oceanside this afternoon, the lesson of a lifetime for a group of third graders on a beach trip.
Well, I was like, wow, that's an oarfish, and because we're studying it in class and stuff. And I was amazed.
Part amazing, part gruesome for some, but so interesting.
It was hard.
Rock hard.
I was thinking, I have no idea what that is. I'm like, it looks like a snake, but it kind of looks like a giant eel.
The tail's a little bit cut off.
A giant dead 13-foot oarfish, a deep water creature that swims at up to 3,000 feet below the surface. An unusual find even for the scientist who came to collect it.
It's so rare to find in Southern California, especially in surface water.
And the second time it's happened this week. This, the picture of the even bigger 15-foot oarfish carcass that washed ashore off the coast of Catalina Wednesday.
They thought it was a very rare event the first time. So this is the These two events that we heard of in the last few weeks are the only ones I've ever heard of.
More poking and prodding to come as scientists plan to slice it up for further inspection.
Right, baffling to scientists even now, but they think that previous 15-foot oarfish likely died of natural causes. In the 10 News Live Center, Riel Creighton, back to you.
So why is there such a lack of information about the oarfish? Numerous sightings and beachings seem to occur across the world, yet the information we have remains limited. Well, the reality is, all of our experiences with the oarfish happen out of their natural habitat. Oarfish are thought to inhabit the epipelagic to mesopelagic ocean layers, ranging from 3,300 feet, and they are rarely seen on the surface. When we do see one on the surface, it's usually on death row, and our time to observe it is limited. Even with this time that we do have, we are observing a fish near depth, out of the environment it spends most of its life in, so the information that we do gain is limited in how applicable it is to the fish in general.
Question, but why is it that we see them so rarely?
Well, it's an offshore species that is not at home in the shallow waters where people are found and where people might readily observe them. They occupy the surface waters, but they do dive fairly deeply. And so we rarely ever see them unless they're in trouble.
Another major reason for this lack of knowledge is cultural disconnect. In the United States, we have had limited encounters with the oarfish and base all of our information off of those few dissections that we've managed to pull off over time. Yet, on Taiwanese and Japanese websites, videos and information regarding the oarfish are abundant, showing that further knowledge does exist. Japan even briefly had an oarfish on display in one of their aquariums in Nagasaki. Without this knowledge, American scientists are going to continue to be left guessing about this complex creature. This mystery surrounding the oarfish and its rare sightings is likely why many folk cultures' legends of sea serpents are nothing more than the tellings of a rare encounter with an oarfish. The oarfish is a staple in Japanese folklore directly, for example, as a warning sign of natural disaster. But the sea serpent seen in other cultures, such as when Saint Olaf is said to have slain a sea serpent and thrown its body into a mountain, are probably also just descriptions of oarfish. However, it's fair to be frightened of an oarfish. With its massive size and limited available information out there, the chances are that each person who sees one alive has no prior knowledge of its existence.
They hunt other large fish as well, I'm assuming.
No, actually they have a very small mouth and actually no teeth, and the available evidence indicates they feed on euphausids, which are small shrimp-like creatures that are quite common in the open ocean.
So where, when, and what are these oarfish sightings? Well, they happen more frequently than you might think, but the time window is incredibly small for multiple reasons. First, if an oarfish is spotted alive, it likely only has minutes to live. And unless a marine biologist is on site, purely by chance, they won't be there to witness this stage. Next, once the fish dies, it again only has limited time before beginning to decay, as many of those who do wash up on the beach wash up with parasites on them. As more time goes on, the body and information gained from it will be less and less useful to scientists attempting to study it, giving us the frustrating problem that a marine expert needs to be on site as the oarfish arrives without having any idea where or when it will arrive.
All right, Kim, happening right now, a rare sight in La Jolla. Take a look at this. This is a massive oarfish just pulled out of the water and hauled away. 10 News reporter Emily Valdez is there live. And Emily, some people believe that an oarfish predicts a major earthquake is on the way.
Yeah, you know, that's been said, especially in Japan before the 2011 earthquake with the tsunami. Japanese fishermen reported seeing a lot of them and for another earthquake in Chile. But, you know, there's no scientific evidence to back that up. We've had a handful of them wash ashore, including the one today at La Jolla Cove behind me. Take a look at this thing. Some people call the sea monster, but they're very elusive, and that's what's so magical about them is they live at 3,000 feet below the sea. So if you see one of these in your lifetime, that's very rare indeed. So we had some guys out there from National Fisheries and Scripps, and they, along with some bystanders, pulled it in because it was already dead. If you see them above the shore, they're usually deceased. So they pulled it in, everyone stood around. Listen to what one bystander said about it.
Very unusual, probably never see that again in my lifetime unless I actually hunt for one. But yeah, it's pretty unreal, pretty uncommon, and exciting for San Diego to have something like that, you know.
And exciting for Scripps Institute of Oceanography. They're taking it right now there, and they're going to dissect it. They want to learn more about these sea creatures because very little is known. I'm live at La Jolla Shores, Emily Valdez, 10 News.
Oarfish lead fascinating lives. They feed primarily on zooplankton, which are tiny versions of crustaceans and other creatures that are hatched at the surface together. We know little to nothing about how they breed and where they come from, but thanks to our dissection of the Californian oarfish washups, we do have some idea on what a pregnant oarfish looks and acts like. Based on precedent with somewhat similar fish, we don't believe that they guard their eggs after dropping them. We do know, however, that their eggs are brightly colored and buoyant, and are about a quarter of an inch long. After about 3 weeks, they hatch into fast-moving larvae that will compete with and eat the other zooplankton among them. They don't look much like their parents at first, resembling more common ocean fish. As they get bigger, they begin to take their place in the depths and their shape as an oarfish, and spend less and less time living near the surface of the ocean.
We came upon this oarfish that was caught at Catalina, and we just contacted the people who had it and say, hey, are you doing anything with the guts? And so they said, no, do you want some? So they shipped up a little styrofoam container with, 10 pounds of guts from this 18-foot fish. They didn't know even what was really the organs inside the oarfish. We were lucky. The key thing is we have 2 inches of intestine where we found everything out of what they sent us. And so it turns out when we did it, it was a pizza party in the lab. You know, we just gathered the people who wanted to look through the oarfish guts. There were about 8 of us. We had no idea we'd find anything. That's why we ordered the pizzas. And we found a surprising amount, 3 very different kinds of parasites. And so it turns out that provides clues to the biology of the oarfish that can't really be easily gotten any other way.
What have we learned about oarfish behavior? Well, for the first time in history, an oarfish was filmed alive in 2001. It was only about 5 feet long when it was spotted by U.S. Navy officers who were on duty inspecting a buoy in the Bahamas. This video gave us major clues into the functioning of the oarfish. First and foremost, we found out that the oarfish has a unique way of moving through the water, called the aniform mode of swimming. They basically stand their body straight up and then rhythmically undulate their dorsal fin to propel themselves. While unique, this method of propulsion is pretty awful for getting anywhere at any decent speed. Scientists believe that an oarfish most likely could not propel itself out of any current in the ocean because of its weak swimming ability. This is one of the main theories as to how oarfish ending up dying on beaches. They simply get caught in currents that don't exist in the deep when they end up coming to the surface, and are swept away from the environment that they do know how to hunt in. Without food or direction, the oarfish are then likely to die. This method of swimming was confirmed again when Jeremy Wade, the star of an Animal Planet show called River Monsters, absorbed the oarfish in what some would consider to be its natural habitat. In what is the only known footage of human interaction with a healthy oarfish in its own environment, Wade witnessed and was even able to physically interact with 2 oarfish who were ascending relatively close to the surface, using the anchor chain of a buoy as a guide. Between these 2 videos, we confirmed how much the oarfish swims and moves in water, but much was still unknown. the Serpent Project, which uses remotely operated vehicles to observe the deep ocean, reported 5 different sightings and observations of apparently healthy oarfish in the northern Gulf of Mexico between 2008 and 2011, giving us our current estimated depths that they lived at, as well as the deepest verified depth of an oarfish we have at about 1,600 feet deep. In a 4-month time spanning 2009 and 2010 in Japan, Japanese folklore concerning the oarfish was reignited when unusual numbers of them washed up on the shore, sending the country into panic in fear of a coming earthquake. Despite the double encounter with Jeremy Wade, oarfish are believed to be solitary animals, and how they find each other for breeding remains largely unknown. Though the furthest confirmed depth of an oarfish is 1,600 feet deep, scientists believe that oarfish could likely and even likely do go as low as 3,300 feet. Now, fish usually have set locations in the world, but as far as we can tell, the oarfish does not. The information we have on their habitats is of course limited to where we see them wash up, and without expert knowledge of every possible route through the currents, it's difficult to predict where they come from. However, based on the fact that they have washed up on the shores of basically every bordering country at some point or another, we can predict that their reign is likely worldwide. A big issue stemming again from cultural distance is the spread of misinformation. For example, researchers in New Zealand once described an oarfish they found as giving off electric shocks when touched. However, no further research in any place has been able to confirm that claim, so it likely wasn't even a real observation. But can oarfish really predict coming earthquakes as Japanese folklore claims they can? Well, scientists are unsure as to the validity of this claim.
A question: could rumblings in the deep be the reason why we are seeing rare oarfish coming ashore in California? 2 washed up last week, and some scientists are now looking into urban legends of animals being able to predict an earthquake. In fact, Japanese lore says that oarfish surface and beach themselves as a sign of an impending quake. 14 washed ashore Japan in March 2010, and it was 1 year before that big earthquake in 2011. Most scientists say, though, there is no concrete evidence that these bottom-dwelling fish sense movement in seismic fault lines.
The Japanese believe that oarfish are associated with earthquakes, and that the arrival of oarfish on the coast is a sort of foretells the coming of an earthquake. But there's really no evidence to support that.
So, with that, I want to bring in Dr. Phil Hastings from the Scripps Institution of Oceanography at the University of California, San Diego. Doctor, thank you so much for being with us today. We appreciate this description of separating between fact and fiction.
My pleasure.
So, is there any possibility that oarfish, from the place where they spend most of their time in the ocean, do they get a peak of seismic activity?
I know of no credible scientific evidence to support that assertion. These fishes are generally found very far from shore, and so would not necessarily be interacting with fault lines like that. And frankly, I know of no sort of sensory systems that they might have that would allow them to detect.
But whether oarfish live up to their Japanese folklore identity or are simply a crazy product of evolution in the deep ocean environment, there's still a ton we have to learn about them. Hopefully, through advancements in technology and more sightings of this elusive creature, we can get to the bottom of what makes them tick. Why their inner workings are so unique, what brings them up to our world on occasion, and whether they can be of legitimate use to us. As an uncertain future with the oarfish approaches, one thing is for sure, we've got a lot to learn.
Oarfish, you're simply more fish. You can grow to 56 feet. You're the kind of fish I'd like to meet. But you're so shy, no one's ever seen you live. You hide way down in the depths, and then wash up, you're such a mess. There you are, there you are, there you are.